Last month, Senate Majority Leader Miguel Zubiri announced he tested positive for COVID-19. After overcoming the disease and 36 days of isolation, he was finally reunited with his family. Joining us in the program, Senator Zubiri, to talk about what it was like to be infected and the difficulties he faced during his journey to recovery. Mr. Senator, good afternoon.
Yeah, good afternoon, Ron and Denise. To everyone listening and watching, good afternoon, sir.
First of all, belated happy birthday. And how was it celebrating COVID-free?
Well, you know, the best gift I ever received was being able to join my family after 36 days of total isolation. Talagang total isolation, Ron, since March 11. And kalalabas ko lang this weekend to be able to join them yesterday. And that was the best gift I think I could ask from the Lord above. I thank God and Mama Mary for taking care of me. It was a really scary experience. And although my symptoms were mild, Ron, but nevertheless, you know, it's the anxiety, you know, because every time you have a cough, every time you have a cold, you think, this is it. You know, this is it. I might end up going to the ICU. So I think more than the physical pain and anxiety, was more the mental anguish. I'm just thankful to the Lord that I'm good. And I'm happy also to hear, Ron, that a lot of other people are recovering. My dear colleague, Senator Angara, right, recovered. Mm-hmm. And I believe Senator Coco is on his way to recovery. So that's good news.
How did you deal with that, with the anxiety and the mental anguish that you just described? And 36 days in isolation, why did it take that long?
Well, first of all, I wanted to make sure that I didn't get anybody else contaminated. You know, traidor itong COVID-19, Ron, no? Konting ano lang, konting the aerosol from your droplets, it could actually infect individuals as far as 10 feet away. So we decided to do a long quarantine. And when I say isolated, talagang walang makakyat sa second floor of my home. They would just put the food on my staircase. I'd get the food and bring it in. And I'd also make sure that nobody's outside the staircase. So I'd put the food outside. And that's how it was for 36 days. There's a protocol of 14 days. But when I was watching international media outlets, Ron, there were cases wherein after the 14 days, people still got infected with the COVID-19 patients. So there's now a study that's coming out from China that it may actually take 21 days to be actually cleared. And at the same time, Ron, when you get your first negative result, we have to wait another 14 days for your second negative result. So there's really a protocol involved. Maybe that's why, those are one of the reasons why our recovery rates are so low. It's because they're really waiting for the end of the quarantine period, which is more or less about a little over 30 days before you can actually be declared as recovered patient.
And how was that for you? 36 long days for a person as active as you. How did you keep busy? How did you keep fit?
You know what, Ron? I just had to do my jumping jacks in the room and, of course, jogging in place. And I had an opportunity. Thankfully, I was at home. So I had an opportunity to talk to my family and to my children. You know, my children are relatively young. They're 12 years old, 10 years old, and 5 years old. So it's like Romeo and Juliet from the balcony. I would talk to them, but they're wearing a mask, fully protected. But I think what really saved me, Ron, number one, was my early action. March 11, I recall, I had the fever. I had the fever, the chills, the body pains on March 11. That was the day after session. That was our last day of session. And I must have gotten this COVID-19 from exposure to people visiting the Senate. I recall that week we had several visitors from the Mayor's League, from the Councilor's League. So probably one was asymptomatic and they probably got me and Senator Sani and the other senators infected. And what I did right away was to take paracetamol. That night at around 11 p.m., March 11, I recall, since I was feeling bad, I took 1,000 milligrams of paracetamol every 6 hours, and that continued for 2 days until all the body aches and pains had actually subsided. And then what I did, Ron, and I'm doing it now for everybody to see, they have to drink I'm drinking now ginger green tea. So salabat green tea. I mix ginger with the green tea. And I drink this every hour, aside from gargling hot water and salt and Bactidol, so that it could kill the germs inside my mouth. And that really helped me. I believe that really helped me in not allowing the virus to go into my lungs. So I did that religiously for almost every hour during that first week and second week. And I think that's what was able to keep me alive and keep me from being intubated and keep me from being being delivered to the or being brought to the ICU.
During that time, were you consulting with a doctor, maybe through text or messages? Yeah.
Yes, I did. I was consulting with a doctor almost every day. I have an uncle that's a doctor in Makati Med, so I would talk to him, Dr. Nuni Fernandez. But also, I'd like to thank several doctors. Dr. Paz Corrales of the DOH, he also reached out to me. And of course, from the Makati City Health Office, si Ma'am Weng, you know, they really reached out to me, made sure that every day they text me asking me how I am. You know, Ron, I'm so happy today. I was listening to the news. There was a news report today in ANC, and they basically said that the government's going to start mass COVID testing. Right. I think that's very, very important, Ron. It's very important because, number one, there's a lot of asymptomatic patients and patients that had mild symptoms that are actual carriers of the COVID virus, which are very dangerous for our frontliners, doctors, nurses, hospital personnel, as well as those manning the checkpoints and in the grocery. So this mass testing will actually help people, particularly in these high-risk areas, to know if they're actually carriers or not.
Right.
So much so that while in isolation, I would like to take this opportunity to thank my friends. We have a group that was able to raise about close to 15 million pesos, and we donated to the UPPGH, Philippine General Hospital. We donated 6,000 test kits to UPPGH, and we also donated about 7,000 test kits to five private hospitals like St. Luke's, Makati Med, Medical City, Asian Hospital, and UST Hospital for their frontline medical personnel. Because, you know, it broke my heart. It broke my heart that while in isolation, I could actually see a lot of our doctors and nurses that were getting COVID-19. Many of them have already died, about 20 or 30 or so very important doctors and nurses, very important to us, to our community. And so we decided to pool our resources together, and I'd like to thank our my good friends, Dr. Steve Lim and Dr. Enrique Posas of St. Luke's, together with Art Rocks. It's our group of art rockers. You know, Cess Drillon and Julius Babo is actually part of that group. And we were able to successfully raise that amount of money and made the donations. We are actually encouraging this now to all the people listening. I know a lot of big companies are making donations to our health services. And I think we should continue that. I think it's a good, strong public and partnership that can happen here. The government can do it alone, as you can see. It's a gargantuan task, and it's going to cost a lot of money, and money is what we lack. And when private sector comes in, that's a big help. So it's the Bayanihan movement that's really strong in our country now, from making face masks in their homes to donating alcohol by these alcohol companies. Instead of manufacturing beer and rum, they're actually giving now hand sanitizers alcohol. So that's a great, great movement that we have to continue. This is not over, you know, it's not going to be over in a short period of time. This will still take a little bit more time, and I think we all have to pitch in.
It's great that you were still able to help despite you being in isolation, and that's nice to know. But during that time, have you thought of any bill that you could file at the Senate that could help the country fight this disease better?
Yes, me and Senator Angara, as well as Senator Coco, in our little chat group in Viber, we decided to come up with particular legislative measures that would be able to help in the long run. This pandemic caught us by surprise. of course, they said that we already knew by January. We already had hearings. Actually, Ron, we had several committee hearings already in the Senate asking the DOH of their preparations for COVID-19. And at that time, they basically said that we were ready. But as you can see now, we lack testing kits. We only have 3,000 respirators all throughout the country. Imagine that, Ron, 3,000 respirators. This is not even in Metro Manila. This is throughout the country. So imagine if our numbers go up to about 10 to 20,000 COVID patients, and let's say 10% of that or 30% of that or 20% of that would need respirators. We will already be running out of respirators, and those patients will be, critically ill, near death. So we have to be really, really prepared for any resurgence of this COVID-19. Because as I said, I don't think this is gonna end anytime soon. I think this will probably linger. Like, that's the finding all over the world. This traidor na virus na ito will be laying around for another recontamination of the population. So unless we have a vaccine, and we don't see that till early next year, unless we have a vaccine, we must be prepared. So when we come into session next month, we have prepared some bills. No, number one, improving the DOH capacity to act on this particular pandemic, or any pandemic for that matter. We had to pass a special law, the Bayanihan Act, Ron. And the Bayanihan Act is a special law given to the president, but it's time-bound. We're only looking at probably 2 to 3 months for the effectivity of the Bayanihan Law. So we're looking at being able to pass another piece of legislation that will be able to grant already the president and the DOH and other frontline government services to act immediately, without having to have a special law, to be able to stock up on essential goods and essential products, for example, or essential materials and facilities. For example, we need to come up with more respirators, more facilities for isolation. We shouldn't be closing PICC every so often, every 3 months, every 4 months, or the Rizal Coliseum to be able to accommodate these patients. We have to have ready facilities, whether it's at the PGH, whether it's at the government centers. You know, in Quezon City, we have a lot of government health centers there that have a lot of land. You're looking at the lung center, which has a lot of land. Mm-hmm. You have other hospitals in Quezon City with a lot of floor area or land area. And we can convert that into isolation facilities. So these are the things that we're looking at long term to be able to give the proper legislation. Biosecurity measures also. We should be, in that law, we should be able to give the president the authority to be able to shut down our airports, our seaports, the mobility of people from one place to the other. Because right now, there could be a violation of certain constitutional provisions on free flow of people and goods to and fro the country. But under this pandemic, we should give the president the legal protection to be able to shut borders. I believe Spain, they're going to do a partial lockdown, but they're still going to continue the no flights, no travel ban, or the no travel, or basically a travel ban all throughout their borders. So we have to be able to give the president that particular legislative power so that he'll be covered, or at least the DOH or the president will be covered from any lawsuits. So, but
just to clarify, those powers you want to grant the president just as long as certain conditions are met.
Yes, and this is only for times like these where we have pandemics and people are dying left and right because of this deadly virus. So these are things looking forward, what we can do in the long run. And also, we have to help in the economic recovery, Ron. I was listening to all the interviews today, and many of them were businessmen outlining the problems that we face in the next 6 months. I'm worried that this year, 2020, the country may hit the recession because this really, if this continues and there's a slowdown in economic movement within our country, number one who will suffer are the MSMEs, the micro, small, and medium enterprises. They don't have the capabilities like Ayala or the Aboitiz and San Miguel Corporation can do to sustain their operation. So we need to look at also giving a legislative package of incentives to these companies to be able to bounce back, because these are the lifeblood of any country. The mm-hmm. economy will run on MSMEs as well as major industries. So at this point in time, we need to study what can be done to be able to pump prime the economy through helping out these businesses as well.
Mr. Senator, it sounds like you've had a lot of things to think about because of this pandemic. Thinking about the pandemic, you've thought about the health aspect as well as the economic aspect. Do you think the Senate will once it reopens and everything is a bit normalized, will be flooded by bills tackling a scenario like this again, we will be better prepared in the future if it happens again?
Absolutely. That's priority number one for us right now. There's a lot of pending legislative measures now in the Senate, but I think this right now is number one priority. How are we going to bounce back from this pandemic in terms of economic development, in terms of biosecurity for our people and for our country? I think that is the number one priority at the moment. And, you know, it's going to be different now. I think, Ron, everything will change from here on. How we meet with each other, how we conduct business. Even the Senate now, many the senators, we have a thread, no? And some of the senators were actually proposing how we can do virtual meetings and conduct mm-hmm. virtual hearings, because it's exactly how I got infected. I got infected by an asymptomatic patient who was walking around the Senate and probably got me and Senator Sani as well as Senator Coco infected. We don't want and we're lucky because we survived it and we're relatively strong. But, you know, we have also some, and I don't want to say this because they might get mad at me, but we also have senators that are a bit older than us, senior citizens. And, of course, they're part of the 1% that are clearly in the danger zone when it comes to the COVID-19. So I think it will completely change. I honestly think that our Senate deliberations, when we open the Senate on May 4th, my suggestion to the Senate President is that we have no guests. I think when you go to the House of Representatives and when you go to Congress or the Senate, you see thousands upon thousands of people there, school kids, counselors, kagawads in the barangay asking for projects and assistance, and basically everyone who can actually come over and ask for assistance. You know, very popular in our offices there, the offices of Senator Bongo, Senator Pacquiao, because, you know, they give cash assistance to these patients. And of course, several of our other colleagues do that, and myself included. But, you know, it opens us up to a possible contamination in the Senate. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So it's going to be very, very different on how we'll be conducting our legislative agenda in the next coming months. But what's important is we're all willing to work, all the senators are willing to work, to be able to come up with long-term solutions on how we can resolve or how we can help this country survive this COVID pandemic.
Senator, quickly, just one more question, and you talked about change. Now that you have recovered and you're finally out of isolation, have you noticed any changes with you? I mean, with the way with your activities, are you being more careful, a little more paranoid than usual? Yes.
You know, I was already paranoid, Ron, I'll tell you. I was the first senator who gave a privilege speech on this COVID-19. That was last early February. I had already asked the Senate President through a privilege speech that we tighten our biosecurity measures in the Senate. And yet I still got
right.
it.
Very ironic.
I know. I was the first one who sounded the alarm bells. I was the first one who did social distancing. I was the first one carrying alcohol in my pocket. And yet I still got it. So that's how dangerous this darn COVID-19 is. Kaya nga, nananawagan nga ako sa lahat. Ang daming pasaway pa rin. I saw pictures on the markets today.
Right, right.
Places of Quezon City. My gosh, please consider this. If not for yourself, think of your family. Think of your grandmother, your grandfather. Think of your parents, yung nanay, tatay nyo. Even think of your children. Kasi pwede pong kayong lumabas, umikot, pasaway, uminom sa kanto, pagbalik nyo, daladala nyo na yung COVID-19 na virus. at mahawaan pa ninyo yung mga mahal nyo sa buhay.
Senator,
that is the worst thing that can happen.
Right. Speaking of family, how did your family deal with this? Did they even recognize you when you got out of isolation with that new beard you have?
Yeah, you know what? I decided not to shave throughout my isolation, and I got them to like it a bit, so I'm going to keep it there until we get out on, out of total lockdown. But what is important is, yes, when they found out on March 16, when the Secretary of the Department of Health, Secretary Duque, called me, my children, one of my children started crying. Because, you know, we watch it in the news. We share the news all the time with each other. And they started crying. My wife, of course, also started crying. And she was, you know, because of the uncertainty, Ron. You don't know. When you watch the news, it's like 50-50. When you get COVID-19, 50% you can survive it. 50% you get intubated and go into the critical phase of this virus. So they took it hard, I think harder than I did. Sabi ko nga, buti na lang ako, no? It was me and nobody else. I was happy that I did what I did, which is to isolate myself March 11 after work. Right. I decided already to pull my family out and to sleep in another area. And thank God I did that. And my wife also, because of that, is negative from that disease. And so it's scary. It's really scary, Ron, for the family. They took it hard. But I guess what was harder was when a doctor called me and told me that I must brace myself because the actual symptoms come out about 6 to 7 days after. So imagine, I was told March 16. So March 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, I was on pins and needles because, as I said, no, every cough I had, every chest congestion, and every pain I felt, whether it was just rheuma, you know, because I have a bit of a rheuma from my Arnis fighting days. I thought it was it. That was it. That was the spread of this, or the disease was getting worse. So technically, yes, it was difficult mentally. I think the mental health issues there, many patients are going through that now, especially those that are isolated in the hospitals and not in their homes, where they have nobody really to talk to and to communicate with. I think that's another aspect we should look into and how we can help them with this. Actually, I thank local news. You know, ANC and the other local news agencies, you do a lot of good and positive stories. And I thank you guys for that. Because when you watch, let me just say it, when you watch international news on TV, I would not have to name them, but when you watch these international news outlets, they're always presenting the number of deaths, the number of people who had acquired COVID-19 and alarming rate of deaths and all these families that died together. Talagang nakakahinaya, no? Nakaka-frustrate, and of course, nakaka-depressed. And that's why I still have to continue to reiterate to everyone that is watching now, sa lahat po natin mga kababayan na nakikinig, traidor po itong COVID-19. Please, nananawagan po kami lahat, lalo na mga survivors katulad ko, huwag po kayo pasaway, huwag po kayo magpasaway at lumabas pa rin. Mag-ingat po kayo when you go out. Always wear a face mask and try to wear gloves. Kung meron po kayong gloves na mabibili, try to wear gloves. And at the same time, mag-ingat po tayo. Kasi kung kayo, hindi po kayo natatakot na mahawaan ito, pag-isipan nyo na mabuti dahil ang matatamaan ito, yung mga mahal nyo sa buhay.
Right.
Your wife can get it, your parents can get it, your grandparents can get it, your children can get it. And most especially, the frontliners who we have to save and protect will be getting it as well. Dahil pag nagkasakit po kayo, pupunta talaga kayo sa ospital at ma-expose na naman muli ang ating mga frontliners, ating nurses and doctors.
Senator, right. Thank you very much for that message. Thank you very much for watching ANC as well.
Thank
We're
you
glad
very
to
much,
know that
Ron.
You're doing well. Thank you for talking
Thank
to
you
us.
So much. Thank God. Thank God. We'll be right back.